We were enemies of the Germans. Our lives had been destroyed and our families had been murdered. So it was strange to be looked at through the barbed wire as if we were animals in a zoo.
Some came as frightened young children, fresh from the kinder transport. Others, like Ravitz and Landau, though stalwarts of the wartime Home Service, were already among Europe's brightest and best. But famous or anonymous, they were all refugees. But what awaited them here was another sort of internment, not deliberately cruel or vindictive, but imprisonment nonetheless. Even fame couldn't save you. Ravitz and Landau entertained the Queen Mother one night, and were behind barbed wire the next.
My parents were left behind in Germany, and the war broke out before I had a chance to organize some kind people to guarantee their life in this country. And although the Home Office permits were ready, they never left the drawer in their offices because the war broke out in September and it was too late. So my parents perished in Auschwitz.
Many aliens, too, are on the move. For Britain, a rise to the danger of fifth column activities must take no chances. However, to be interned in Britain is like paradise when compared with a Nazi concentration camp, so there shouldn't be any complaints here.
Like paradise, no complaint. Breezy, insensitive wartime words. But for young Jews, cast among strangers, orphaned, most would never see their parents again, the reality was very different.
The prison warden took me up many steps, and finally, a dark room was opened, and a torch showed me where to lie down. And at this moment, I shed the only tears for the next following weeks.
And then I was found a cell in the dark, in a wing that hadn't been opened for, I think, 80 years. But nobody was brutal. It was just rather shocking.
One NCO was heard to say, I never knew there were so many Jews among the Nazis.
Jewish Nazis, the surreal ignorance of a nation that until then had chosen to ignore the threat of Hitler. Now, with the collapse of Holland, there was suddenly talk of Nazi sympathizers. It was decided that the place to find them was among those who'd already fled Hitler. As a result, 27,000 Germans and Italians, most of them refugees, were interned.
They largely invented this myth of an enemy within, which turned out to be completely untrue as far as Britain was concerned. Virtually every Nazi agent in Britain was rounded up right at the beginning of the war. This claim was made by the chief of MI5 at the time, and it was later confirmed by the Home Secretary, who said that if there ever had been a network of Nazi spies in Britain, they were effectively dealt with in the first month or two of the war.
Spy mania or a sensible regard for the nation's security? It didn't matter much either way to those unlucky enough to be caught up in it. Like fame, anti-fascist credentials were no protection. Wolfgang von Leyden was a student at Oxford whose family had fought fascism.
We were one day called up to assemble in the three main halls, and since no particular purpose had been communicated to us, we simply assembled where we were or where was the nearest room to go to. And so after we had all assembled in those three rooms, an announcement was made that one of these vast rooms would be the room in which the people would be sent to Australia. Another room was the room in which people would be sent to Canada. And the third room in which I, happened to be were the people who would be sent to the Isle of Man. Almost as though one was set free. Beautiful. It looked to me as though it was an Italian island, like Ischia or Capri. Very, very attractive.
The Isle of Man, the poor man's Riviera, with its motorbike racing and casinos, the nearest the mill workers of Burnley and Blackburn would ever get to life in the fast lane. But now there were no Lancashire or Scots holidaymakers. There was a war on. The no vacancies signs had come down with the illuminations. The tall Victorian battlements of hotels and boarding houses were lying empty. Where better to house the internees? Once a protective ring of barbed wire had been put in place. This little island, clinging to the very edge of Europe, was suddenly host to the cream of the continent's artists and musicians. Peter Gellhorn was already one of Europe's most promising pianists. When he was interned, he was allowed no musical scores, and the only book he brought, A Study of Scarlatti, was taken from him. But the waters of Ramsey Bay, which separated his internment peninsula from the main island, couldn't separate him from his music.
Well, I've never done more music in my life than I did here. Of course, I hadn't got my music, but I eventually reconstructed my piano repertoire, bit by bit, bar by bar, so to speak. And eventually I got most of my pieces in trim again. And I gave various piano recitals without ever having to repeat a piece and without having the music here. And opposite the house where I had a harmony class, I remember having little blackboard on which I wrote notes and so on, staves. Then in the Snæfell Hotel, as it was then called, we did concerts and rehearsals, and we had a cabaret too. The English officers came to our performances quite often. There was a very good violinist, a man called Sidney Engel, who didn't speak a word of German because his family had emigrated to England in the 1880s. Well, this certainly looks changed. And the camp also taught us that the world inside and outside the camp were not so different from one another, really. Otherwise, it was really a microcosm of the world. Well, this is now nearly 50 years. Yes, this is 50 years since I was released. It's about this time in January I got out. It's exactly 50 years ago. There was practically a university in this camp. The young people could, the doctors had one house where they had seminars every day. People were learning things all the time as well. I think there were one or two Nobel Prize winners among the internees, professors and scientists. They did lectures. Like in a university, they lectured on all subjects you can imagine. I remember when we were released, we looked back at the gate and there were the faces of the people who were left behind. They were quite a few months longer than we were. And one of my friends who was released with me said, yes, the faces look strange and it's sad to look at them, but it's not as bad as looking at the faces in Buchenwald when you got out of that, knowing that you probably not see any of them alive again. Whether you're free or not, it's really something that happens inside you. Nobody can make you a prisoner if you don't want to be one.
But there is one musical legacy above all others that we owe to the Isle of Man and internment. When Sigmund Nissel arrived on the island, he was a young, unknown violinist. There he met a fellow internee, the late Peter Shidlock, and here they began the musical partnership that was the genesis of the world's most famous string quartet. Have to be a celebrity to be interned. Wolfgang Salinger and Fred Olsberg were just up the promenade from Sigmund Nissel's camp.
This is a long time. Well, yeah.
They joined them in this rediscovery of their past.
Yeah, changed.
Oh, this is.
I used to think that when we were interned that this was the darkest moment in my life, which indeed it was. I mean, I never experienced such fear and such forebodings as when we were interned. The danger was that we would be, if the Germans succeeded to invade Great Britain, that we would be handed over to the Nazis on a plate, with very little chance to escape or go underground. But in retrospect and with hindsight, all the good things that have happened right here in Douglas and in Onchan during that year when I was interned here.
On a day like today, I do feel that I felt more depressed because there were the Manx people and also the holidaymakers, which were still coming to the island, walking freely outside in the beautiful sunshine, and we were behind barbed wire. That was hard to take.
The two friends and the famous musician sampled together for the first time the beauties of the Isle of Man. Delights which 50 years ago they could only glimpse between the strands of barbed wire or through a boarding house window.
We knew we had done nothing wrong. We knew we were not enemy aliens, although we were classified as enemy aliens. But therefore, although we very much resented the imprisonment, because that's what it was, we really felt it'll all be sorted out in the end.
I suppose we felt bitter to the point that we saw the beautiful island and we couldn't get to it.
And that flat, the one with the flat hole.
Oh, the flat will pay, yes.
That's the one. That's right.
That to many others.
Yes, there's a ceiling.
Yeah.
There's a train in my room.
The local population thought we were the first batch of Nazi prisoners.
That's absolutely correct. They stood and gaped, open mouths.
Open mouths.
Yes. Yeah.
So that's what the enemy looks like. Yeah. Ach, wie reizend, ach, wie nett, ist doch so ein Stringquartett. Wenn die Leute, die das playen, plenty von dem Job verstehen und die vier in Harmonie strictly counten, one, two, three.
And that was a wonderful mixture of,
that's
camp jargon.
Yeah. Well, that is refugee English, as spoken in Swiss Cottage.
I mean, you know the one about the refugee couple.
When people look back, they rarely look back in anger. They say you only remember the good things, but perhaps that's because the good things are the most important.
There was, of course, a positive side of this internment as well. There were hundreds of people kept together, and one made friendships. I made friendship with Fred, who lasted over 50 years or more and still exists to this day. One had a feeling of community spirit because we were all in the same boat and we all had to work together and make it as pleasant as possible under very trying circumstances.
Just well, as we remember it, isn't
absolutely.
It?
Absolutely.
Hasn't changed at all.
That sight has lived with me for 50 years of all those little boarding houses side by side.
Yes.
Oh, look at this. Drunken Pleasure Park.
It wasn't that 50 years ago.
It certainly wasn't the Pleasure Park of those days.
Very different. Where we are now standing now, roughly, is where the gate was. The main gate was across here.
Across the road
across the road here, and then the fence on down the centre of the road.
Absolutely.
We were on the right-hand side of it, the left-hand was out of bounds.
And the guards were against the fence on this side.
That's right.
And what was that over there?
The commandant's office.
The whole of that block. Yes.
With a special pass of the special dispensation, you can go and see the commandant.
But it certainly wasn't a pleasure park.
No, never.
Well,
Douglas out of the season is rather a sleepy sort of nostalgic place.
Sleeps all the time, no? Well, I can remember these. From here on, this should be the camp from here on down to the end there.
Could easily be the house.
And they've all been painted since then, I know.
Yes. They were pretty flaky when we were there.
Maybe some of your music's still in one of these houses.
Oh, yes, it could be that I've forgotten something. Is this still run as a hotel?
Well, unfortunately, it's in the process of shutting at the moment.
I volunteered to work in the kitchen and we were very lucky because we drew the rations every morning outside on the pavement and each house had to cook for itself. Mm-hmm. And in this house, probably this one, we had the cook of the Café Royal, a very famous restaurant.
Very nice too.
So we did very well and I volunteered to work in the kitchen.
Mm-hmm.
And so I earned my cigarette money.
At least you got well fed.
I was still smoking then.
This is about where the fence was.
Yes, about halfway across the road.
And there was a double fence.
Yes.
And the guard company were between the two fences. We were on that side, and that side was the other world. And what was below there, we never knew. We never saw this.
No. We didn't even know there was such a...
Yeah.
It was probably just a
It was there. It
a
was,
meadow.
There was greenery there. But yes. We never looked at this. The view we have now, we never had.
No. One didn't feel very strongly about it, but it was strange, people looking in through the barbed wire and looking at us, and they didn't understand who we were. I don't think there was a great knowledge of refugees from Nazi oppression, from Central Europe. I don't believe that the population as a whole knew really why we were here and what we were, and they just classed all Germans together and thought we were Germans.
Of all these little houses.
Yes.
But I don't believe we found ours yet.
No, we are lower
because
down.
Because we're nowhere near in the centre.
Yeah, we are much lower down, I think, from memory. The stupidity was recognised by everybody almost immediately, and afterwards. After we came out, I think we made subconsciously or consciously, we made an effort to integrate into society and to become useful members of the society we were living in.
Yeah. Ah, marvelous.
And when we first arrived here, it was the darkest moment in my life. And all the good things that have happened since then started from here. I was a member in the camp of the Vienna Philharmonic, and I had violin lessons from him. So that was absolutely terrific. Yes, I've become an incurable optimist. If anyone had foretold what the next 50 years would bring, I wouldn't have believed it standing in this spot. And it did happen. And it was only because I was here in this camp that I met people who seemed to have recognized that my future colleague, Peter Schittler, and myself had talent and recommended us to probably the best teacher in Europe, in London. And as a result of that, he said he would teach us without taking any money, Professor Max Rostow. And he kept his word, and that was the beginning of all the good things. Ah, marvelous. But of course, we looked with envy out to the sea. I would have loved to have a swim out there, but we were never allowed that. But it was quite good in a way. We saw people walking up and down, and, well, they looked at us a little bit like we were in cages. And we looked, and I don't know what animals in a zoo look like.
Would you mind very much if we had a look round?
Not at all.
Because this was our home for many months.
Yes.
Come
on in then. It's a bit different,
I think. I'm sure there are no carpets.
No?
No carpets, no mirrors, nothing. Everything was completely bare.
That's right. Well,
they were like this. There were two beds here.
Yes, one there.
One there and one here.
Yes. So, no bed linen, just one pillow, three blankets each.
Well, this is it.
This is the view that we had.
Yes. I'm absolutely fascinated by all this.
Yeah.
Yes. I even remember the rake off the ceiling. Mm.
It all comes back, you know. But if somebody had asked you a fortnight ago to remember what you were talking about now, you wouldn't have done.
I couldn't have described it in detail as I now remember it all.
We're
most grateful to you. It's very kind of you to let us see it.
A natural grace that springs from a well-founded friendship. But it's important to remember that this, like the music, was an accidental bonus. There was still the stupidity of it all, like the famous lecture by a veteran German spy.
And the most absurd situation arose because he was a very nice, old, harmless man who potted around the camp and did a little bit of gardening. For our own entertainment, it was arranged that he would give an evening talk of his experience of how he had escaped from the British when they had captured him. Now, anything more absurd or macabre, you can't imagine. It had to be invented almost in the country.
And yet, for every crass stupidity, there was an act of sensibility and insight. The British composer, Ralph Vaughan Williams, chaired a committee which decreed that a young, obscure violinist, interned behind barbed wire, was a person of outstanding artistic merit. And as a result, gave the world the music of the Amadeus String Quartet.
They will never let you out. It serves you right, you so and so. Why aren't you a naturalized Eskimo? Just tell yourself.
Oh.
It's marvelous.
It is marvelous.
could have been better. Just think of it.
Victims of hatred again seem to have this capacity for lifelong friendship. René Godard and Marianne Georgiou first met in Holloway Jail. After that, they were sent here to Port St. Mary on the beautiful southern tip of the Isle of Man. Together, they've returned.
If you survive something, you remember the good times. I do remember the good times. And the Isle of Man and Port St. Mary in particular is a very extraordinarily beautiful place. You remember the comradeship. In a funny way, of course, you're in prison and you resent that, but you're also very secure together.
And I think my great interest in people has been very much stimulated by this time on the Isle of Man. And I realized that not everybody had such a happy time as my friend and myself. But for myself, I never regretted it, nor would I ever blame anybody for it.
This is Marianne.
Marianne, how do you do?
I'm really
nice to see you.
Yes. Again, after all.
Yes. What, 50 years ago,
yes,
we came here from London to be interned.
That's
right. Wonderful to be back.
Well, do come in.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I have three ladies who come back, and they come from Hull. Yes, the three of them are here together.
Really?
And you look very sorry lot. Because you'd been in, I think, Holloway, hadn't you?
That's right.
But we were so pleased when we came here.
Yes, and we were so sorry for you because you looked so, well.
Well, we welcomed the change from Holloway prison.
And you did look after us.
But I'm very glad you have happy memories of your internment. I know it was something that had to be done.
Oh, well, I really enjoyed it.
So did I.
The only thing that was difficult was, like for everybody, we didn't know how long.
No.
Nor did we know. No, it was very bad times, wasn't it? France.
It was very bad times. Mm. You know, they, with being Jewess, as you say, I think they were persecuted before they came here. And when we were doing so badly, they were threatening what they'd do. They would commit suicide.
Oh, I see. Well, this was all our fear. I mean, the greatest fear was...
In the sea. They were all going in the sea. And my mother calmed them and said, no, they'll never come here, you know. Although we were doing badly. I shouldn't tell us.
Oh, do tell us.
Our boyfriend.
Oh, did how you? Did that affect you? I mean, how
well,
did
they... Did.
Well, they went and flirted with the internees.
Well, it's very good of you to come back.
The plight of Jewish children driven from Germany has stirred the sympathy and conscience of the rest of the world. Here is the first group arriving at Harwich. Every child has a label giving particulars, labels that emphasize the pathos of the picture. For many of these innocents don't even know the whereabouts of their parents, let alone their fate.
They were already 16 by then, and it was a matter of I'm getting out of Germany or I'm not. Unfortunately, since then, I've heard that the rest of the children, after I left, were taken to concentration camp. They were all gassed, the whole lot. So I just managed to get out in time.
The distinguished artist Peter Minchley was one of those labelled children, dispatched across Europe like so much discarded baggage. An unclaimed package which, fortunately for him and us, ended up here in Hutchinson Square, the artist colony of the internment camp.
Every morning, standing by the wire, seeing a girl going to work, a very beautiful girl. She must have been living just a few houses further up. And it might just be my imagination in those days. She might not have been beautiful. But to me, she was behind the barbed wire. And people weren't allowed to talk to us anyhow. So it was a hopeless situation.
He's returned to complete a picture he's had in his mind's eye for half a century. his own gesture of thanks to the unorthodox academy where he learned his craft.
Perfect, absolutely perfect. The variety of artists was enormous, from musicians to architects to painters to sculptors. Of course, that led me direct into painting. It helped me a great deal. I always wanted to paint, and here was the opportunity of meeting people. I had a chance at last to paint from morning till night every day and learn.
Artists are really very lucky because they can do what they always wanted to do, even in internment. Hitler wanted to impose on all German artists his particular concept of a really very Philistine Austrian tradition. And what was created here was German art which was forbidden in Germany. It is the survival of German art in the various internment camps.
An Orthodox, anarchic even, but without internment, there would have been a major gap in the history of 20th century German art. The authority for this is Claus Henriksen, who spread the fame of the Hutchinson Square School of Artists. He was already a young art historian when, faced by the moral dilemma of conscription into Hitler's army, he chose freedom, even if that freedom at first turned out to be internment on the Isle of Man.
An art dealer from Berlin approached him, the commandant, and said, we have got a number of well-known artists here who are desperate for material. And he said, well, what can I do? And he said, it's not a very great problem. If we give you a list, would you get the things? And he said, yes, I will do this, and I will do more. If they are good artists, I will give them a studio space, which, of course, was the most wonderful thing for all of them, because the houses, each of these little houses, had at least 30 people living in them. You couldn't work anywhere.
None of it would have been possible without this man. Captain Daniels is a veteran of the First World War, who, in spite of advancing age, volunteered for the second. He must have hoped for a more heroic and glamorous posting than the officer commanding of an internment camp on the Isle of Man. Yet, right from the start, he alone seems to have had some inkling of the remarkable talents sheltering under the eaves of Douglas's boarding houses. He even went so far as to arrange for this unique photographic record of the camp's daily routine. This is the morning roll call. And these are the married men, waiting for their weekly conjugal visit to their wives. At first, the camps were strictly segregated. Only later were their married quarters. They say the Isle of Man is the island that times forgot. And certainly, even today, it's not hard to conjure up again, half a century later, the spirit of the world created by Captain Daniels from his company headquarters.
I have sometimes wondered what Captain Daniels thought when he looked down here. Because obviously he had spent his life at Unilever. He had never met very many foreigners, and suddenly he saw about 1,500 walking up and down, and he felt that he should do something for all these internees.
On the few occasions I was actually allowed to go to the internment camp to see my father, in fact, the only time I really saw around the camp was in charge of the regimental sergeant major, who was, I believe, the head porter at the Dolphin Square block of flats in London. I think he was proud. I think he had a fairly rough ride because there weren't all that many people who really thought that the Germans, the internees, would be having it quite so easy. And I even felt at times that there was even a sort of an anti-Semitic feeling still in the country at the time. I think my father was very proud that he was able to help these hapless internees and to give them their pianos and artistic materials and books. Yes, he was proud.
He helped me. He wrote to the Home Office that I was underage. I should be released from the camp. He had a reply from the office. I was called back again that they couldn't release me as I was not registered to be in the camp. I didn't exist. I wasn't registered, so I couldn't be released. So therefore, I had to stay on while other people left. I stayed on rather a long time. Major Daniel, who was very helpful, very kind man, listened and tried to help at least.
The Council of Life was very active. Not only all the artists, but also concerts. Very ambitious. I think 8 full concerts in 3 months. And at the same time, there were theater performances. A theater group was formed. And a cabaret, of course, started straight away, which dealt more with topical questions. One of the topical questions was, did we get bromide in the sugar to suppress the sexual urges of the internees? So they wrote a new script, which was called Romeo and Juliet. Nothing happened.
But Romeo and Juliet was nothing when compared with the anarchic language of Hutchinson Square's most famous occupant. Kurt Schwitters was not only one of the 20th century's most famous artists, he was a Dadaist poet and painter. Dadaism was a movement which sprang up in Germany after the First World War. It celebrated the irrational and the surreal. The world of the camps, where opponents of Hitler were locked up in case they sabotaged the war against Hitler, seemed the natural home for a Dadaist.
Schwitters came later than any of us because he had left Germany after the degenerate art exhibition where his works were specifically chastised and criticized by Hitler, where pictures were always juxtapositioned from works which were done by lunatics in lunatic asylums and by the leading German artists. And Schwitters was under the section Total Verrückt, totally mad. And the picture had been hung, the large collage, this way, upside down. And of course, all Schwitters' works were collected and taken out of circulation. This particular picture, in front of which he was photographed, has been lost. That has never been found.
But Hitler merely seems to have added to Schwitters' fame. Today, his collages fetch thousands of dollars. This is his last work, the famous Barn Wall, from his post-war Lake District period, which was transported across the Pennines to Newcastle University's Hatton Gallery. But perhaps the camp, with its use and reuse of any and every object, remains the truest memorial to Schwitters and Dadaism.
It helped me to make my own materials, even if it's a matter of getting just one colour, like taking a brick down, rubbing it down, and into powder, and then mixing it with linseed oil, which produces an oil paint. Canvases we didn't get. It was all done on boards, bits of hardboard, bits of any type of board one could find. And had I known how famous he was or became, I wish I'd kept the boards that he gave me to paint on, the boards that he had finished with. I would be a really rich man right now.
His was the most famous name of artists. He was an extraordinary character. His most original performance was that he took a cup and a saucer, which was extremely scarce in this camp here, and he started moving the one in front of the other and saying, "Silence, silence, silence, silence," throw the thing in the air and smash it, you know, which of course was unbelievable, the shock that somebody deliberately broke one of these values. But it had a cathartic effect because it was really a sort of protest against this whole situation. He apparently couldn't sleep in a bed. He had to sleep underneath the bed, so as if it was a kennel. And being in a kennel, he also imagined that he was a dog. So therefore, before going to bed, He started barking regularly every evening. And one day, he was over there, one day a banker from Vienna, who had a lifelong suppressed the urge also to bark, could control himself no longer and barked back. So there were suddenly, night after night, two barking dogs in a square where no animals were allowed. So when this went on for two or three days, the army was sent out to chase these dogs, which of course were never traced.
But Schwitters could be conventional enough when he wanted. Perhaps in deference to the artistic tastes of his friendly warders, his picture at the centerpiece of the internee's own art exhibition was an Orthodox painting. The other works on display were also far from Dadaism and its concepts. They included this fine bust of the internee's more famous celebrity, the pianist Rabbits.
He asked Rabbits whether he would give a concert, and Rabbits said yes, but I need a proper instrument. So there were about a dozen pianos in the whole, in all these boarding houses, and he tried one after the other. Eventually, one, under the impact of his very powerful hands, completely collapsed the whole thing. And the panels of the piano were given to the sculptors, and the barbed wire, the wire was used for making illicit electric fires by the technical school, and the ivories were given to an animal trapper who made dentures out of them, and the casters were used for something else, so eventually this whole piano has disappeared. Concert took place, the commandant invited all the other commandants and his superior officers from the island and the ladies, and they were all sitting down there on that particular first green, and of course all the internees were there, about 1,500, and Rabbits played on, they hired for him obviously a grand piano, and he played on, and it was a memorable event.
To me, the camp wasn't anything abnormal. It was so institutionalized most of my life. I was sent periodically to kindergartens, which were my first institution. From there into the orphanage camp boarding school, from there to England, and from there to internment camp, back into the army, back into a college, and ending up actually lecturing at a college again. Another institution, the final institution. And the very final institution is still to come very soon.
It was another of those inspired interventions, this time by Sir Kenneth Clarke, which gave Peter Midgley his freedom. Once again, a young, obscure painter was designated an artist of outstanding merit.
For artists, it was really quite good because they were occupied. But if you are a publisher or some kind of engineering manufacturer, so you couldn't do anything here. And many people succumbed to this and just played cards all day long. Or else were walking around and doing nothing and moaning and groaning. The important thing was, from the point of morale, to get everybody involved. But as it is, people were having tremendous depressions, particularly when bad news came from London. There was a suicide. There were people who had to be taken into the local hospital. The first evening when I came, there was a completely distraught, very old doctor with a very long white beard, and he got this beard entangled in the barbed wire. So he was standing tearing in all directions. So other internees were trying to get it disentangled from the inside, and the soldiers did it from the outside. It's one of my most vivid impressions to see a man with a long white beard. He eventually then was transferred to the hospital. We were not prisoners of war. We were not civil internees, but we wanted to be treated as people who had been certified as being reliable and as being victims of Nazi oppression. So a committee was appointed to find the real status, and that was His Majesty's Most Loyal Enemy Aliens, which stuck, which I think is a very good title.
Gentlemen, representing the jailer, can I show you the album which was given by the artist of the Hutchison internment camp to my father in 1941?
That exists.
So look,
to be neat. You open it.
God. But look at this. Hutchison internment camp. Thank you, sir. Would you know?
If you were looking for memorial to internment, this work, offered as a gesture of thanks to a man who did something to soften the unintentional cruelties of a wartime bureaucracy, would be hard to match. But it also points forward to something else, the remarkable contribution these artists and scholars made to the life of their adopted land. Putting behind them any resentment they may have felt at being interned, they did their best to defeat Hitler. And once he was beaten, their music, painting, and industry has enriched all our lives.
We were forever looking out over the bay, waiting for the ferry to come from Liverpool. And
English or French?
But there's yet another bonus. They've allowed us to share in the friendship and comradeship they feel for one another.
You
mean after the bulk of the people had gone?
After we'd all gone.
Either
released or gone up to Ancre, and it was absolutely empty. And we had to go back there to pick up bits of paper to make a little bit more order.
Yes.
And it was a very eerie feeling to walk back into the empty camp.
Oh, yes, I can imagine
and
that.
And clear up, and even walking back again to one's own room that one had been in. It was like something that had lived and suddenly died because everybody had gone.
Well, it had been your home for such a long time. Who would have thought?
Yeah.
50 years later, we meet here.
We will be next to the theatre.
We must drink to that.
Cheers.
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 Bottoms up.
Cheers.
My book was pretty quickly smuggled into the Isle of Man camps and helped greatly to revive their morale. When one refugee was released, his fellow inmates gave him this piece of barbed wire and asked him to get in touch with me and present it to me as a token of their appreciation. And I have kept it ever since as a symbol of all these events.
And now, gentlemen, may we pay tribute to the great British nation and play your immortal song, Home Sweet Home.